Hello and welcome to the world of managerial accounting. I bet it's hard for you to believe that there's yet another accounting course that you have to get through. But this one's really important. No matter what career path you decide to pursue, managerial accounting is really going to help you develop tools for good decision making. And you're going to need decision making no matter what major you decide to pursue. So we're going to start off with the prologue. I know you can't believe you actually have to read a prologue to a textbook, but there's a lot of important vocabulary information related to managerial accounting in this chapter. So it's important that you review it and read it. And there's certain things in this chapter that I don't spend a lot of attention on in the lecture, but you should still skim through it to make sure you have a general understanding of all the material covered. The focus I'm going to give you is on what I think is the most important, and that's what you'll be held accountable to on any exam or quiz in this class. So let's get started. This is extremely important for you to understand, especially having come from financial accounting. You might want to know why you need to take this other course. What are the differences between financial and managerial accounting? Well, we'll start with the users. The users of financial accounting, you may remember, are the external users, like the lenders, investors, government entities, suppliers of the business. They're all using that accounting information. Now, that doesn't mean managers don't use financial accounting information to make decisions. They do, but the primary focus of financial accounting is to summarize what's happened over the years, create financial statements to provide that summary information, and then get that information out to external users. Managerial accounting obviously focuses on the manager, so the managers of the business. So we're going to be manipulating financial accounting information in order to make it more useful for managerial decisions. In addition, our focus is going to change from that of history, which is what financial accounting dealt with, historical perspective, past perspectives, and we're going to focus on the future in managerial accounting. So as you can imagine, managers can learn from the past, but they really have to think to the future with respect to the growth and success of the business. So managerial accounting has a future emphasis. Because of the perspective change or the time focus, financial accounting is much more verifiable and objective, whereas managerial accounting isn't as verifiable because if you're predicting future behavior, you can't verify that to be true until after the fact, but it is going to be very relevant to your decision making. Focusing all in the past isn't going to help you make relevant decisions. And because of that, financial accounting focuses on precision. Managerial accounting focuses on timeliness. Meaning in managerial accounting, the information we have may not be perfect, but it'll be good enough and available at the time we need to make a decision. The subject for financial accounting is really on the company as a whole. In managerial accounting, we drill down a little deeper and look into the segments of a business. And the rules in financial accounting, you may remember, are GAAP, Generally Accepted Accounting Principles for the United States, and IFRS, International Financial Reporting Standards for other countries. Managerial accounting is not bound by GAAP or IFRS. We can basically do what we want. However, before you get too excited thinking you won't have to memorize any rules, there are procedures and techniques that you will learn, and formulas, etc., throughout the course that will help us make better decisions in managerial accounting. Managerial accounting is not mandatory like financial accounting, but any company that wants to be able to be successful and make good, sound decisions really needs to focus on some type of managerial accounting in their day-to-day operations. There are three primary items that management needs to focus on in their day-to-day activities, and those are planning, controlling, and decision-making. With planning, you're establishing goals and then figuring out how those goals will be achieved. And one of the ways we can communicate our plans is by developing a budget. You may have heard about budgets before. It's basically a monetary plan to determine what we're going to due in the upcoming period of time, a month, a year, a quarter, whatever the case might be. So the budget is going to forecast revenues and expenses for the upcoming period, and that is how we communicate to our employees what we expect from them. Then at some point, we're going to compare the actual results to the budget in order to assess how those employees did. Were they able to achieve their goals or not? That's going to be part of the controlling function. So the controlling function gathers feedback to ensure that the plans are being followed. So as part of controlling, we're going to be comparing the actual results to the budget numbers to determine if we've done our work appropriately or not. If we do a good job, we want to continue that going forward. And if we make mistakes, then we're going to want to obviously mitigate that and fix it. Managerial accounting is used for decision making. Decision making involves making selection between alternatives, like what should we be selling, who should we be serving, how should we execute a particular decision. So we really need to have useful information in order to make these types of decisions. Our decision is only going to be good or as good as the information that we base it on. Before we move on, if you actually skim through the prologue, which I highly recommend that you do, it'll give you some examples of how planning, directing, and controlling apply to different career paths. So even if some of you decide not to follow the path that is far better than any other, accounting, and you follow a path in marketing, hospitality, management, etc., there are a lot of good examples in the prologue as to how planning, directing, and controlling would apply to your major. So that really is important because I need you to buy into this course. I need you to see the value in this course, because if you don't, you're really not going to learn it very well, because you're not going to want to learn it. You're going to think it's a waste of your time. And I cannot stress enough how important the material we cover in this class will be to your future, no matter what career path you decide to pursue. Now back to accounting. So in financial accounting, there are various certifications. For instance, I'm a CPA, a certified public accountant. There's also certifications for accountants that work internally for a business and play a large role in managerial decision making. That would include the CMA, which is a certified management accountant designation, as well as the CGMA, which is another designation that is co-sponsored by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants and the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants. And both certifications require that the person have experience and then pass an exam, much like the CPA exam would. So I only bring this up to make you aware that there are certain certifications in both the public accounting field, which is really financial accounting related, as well as the managerial accounting field. These certifications allow you to differentiate yourself from your peers and usually lead to better job opportunities and job growth. So again, managerial accounting focuses on planning, controlling, and decision making. So the primary purpose of this course is to teach you measurement skills that managers use to support these different activities. So everything we learn in this course is somehow going to be utilized in one of these three fundamental activities: planning, controlling, and directing or decision making. Measurement skills help managers answer important questions, such as how should I create a financial plan for the next year, or how well am I performing relative to my plan. It's extremely important that we develop plans that are achievable, but also a plan that's going to motivate employees to do better, to improve. So we're looking at how well we're performing relative to the plan. That's part of the controlling feature, right? You have a plan, you have to make sure you're performing well in comparison to that plan. Ethics are important in accounting. It's no different in managerial accounting. And the Institute of Management Accountants has a statement of ethical professional practices that basically provides guidelines for what is expected in ethical behavior. It's important to have these guidelines because everybody's version of ethics is different. An example I would normally tell you in class would be one time when my wife found a $100 bill in the Hannaford's parking lot, and she came home and told me, and I was really excited. I'm like, we could use this $100. I'm a teacher now. I need the money. And she told me she turned it in, and I was very disappointed. I said, how could you do that? Finders keepers, losers weepers. And she ultimately told me, you know, basically that I was a jerk and you should do unto others as you want done unto you. And the moral of the story is my wife's wonderful and I'm a schmuck. But a month later, Hannaford called her and told her that nobody came to claim the $100 and it was hers anyways. So she ended up getting the $100 with a good conscience. But, you know, usually I'd ask how many of you would return the $100, and a couple people raise their hands and say they would, but the vast majority of us wouldn't. So what is ethical? What is not? And that's what the ethical standards are needed for, to put everyone on the same wavelength. So there's different elements. Competence, obviously the person who's preparing the information has to have the knowledge necessary to provide that information both correctly and in a timely fashion. And then there's confidentiality. Obviously we have information that needs to be confidential. We might be privy to certain trade secrets and other things related to our company, our employer, and we should not be giving out that information to anybody else. So it's really common sense, but there has to be rules in place so everybody knows what expectations need to be followed. And then there's integrity. We basically want to make sure that we're acting in the best interests of our employer and the community. We want to refrain from any conduct that would prejudice carrying out our duties ethically and avoid doing things that would discredit the profession, like lying, cheating, and stealing, committing fraud. And then credibility means that the information that we provide has to be reliable. Okay, and again, that ties into the whole concept of not committing fraud. The information that managerial accountants provide are used for decision making. If that information isn't credible, it's effectively useless. Why do we need ethical standards? Well, I already mentioned that ethical standards are needed because not everyone follows the same path. Not everyone views what is right and wrong in exactly the same way. So ethical standards in business are essential for the smooth functioning of an economy. Without the ethical standards, the economy and all of us who depend on it would suffer. And then abandoning ethical standards in business would lead to a lower quality of life with less desirable goods and services and higher prices, right? If you didn't have any ethical standards, you'd be price gouging left and right. And ultimately, society as a whole would be hurt. And the business would be hurt in the long run from doing that.